Boom, we are live, ladies and gentlemen. We are very excited to have two of the founders of the company known as Alfa Vedic. Today we are going to be going over C60 as a specific, and we'll branch off into a few other ideas. We've got Barre, Lando, as well as Mike Winner on the channel. How are you both doing this afternoon?
Hey, good to be back. I'm a big fan of the Arcane Barre and very active with the community, so I'm very happy to be back on the show. Some viewers might remember me from last year. I was on a crypto project we were doing, a festival coin. And so very involved in the crypto world. And actually have a new project called Manifest X, which we could talk about some other time. But Alfa Vedic is my main company that we focus on. And while we love crypto, we also love health and all sorts of cool stuff we'll talk about today. And super excited to get into C60 for sure. And love for everyone to meet Dr. Barre Lando.
Hi, everybody. Teal, I'm honored to be here. Thank you. I'm a kind of backwards farmer doctor, so this is unusual for me to be out here in the public eye at all. So this should be fun. And thank you for having us.
Yeah, of course. So I guess what we'll do is we'll just dive right into it. Barre, maybe give us a little bit of the background of how you started in the medical field and farming, and then where we are today, I guess, with Alfa Vedic. Because I want to focus on C60, I guess, specifically. I know we'll have you guys back to go over a few more of the conversations, but I think if we can stay focused in one kind of niche, we'll have a really well-rounded conversation today. So fill us in with your background first.
Sounds good. My academic background is all over the place, so I'll do the best I can. But, you know, really my roots are in athletics. That's how I attended university, on athletic scholarships. And I've been a lifelong practitioner of the martial arts and competed in that, and still active very much more in the internal arts. So that's a big part of my life. And I feel like with the internal martial arts, I've learned infinitely greater amounts about life and everything involved than I ever learned in school. But the school is, for me, it was a paper game, and I knew that you had to have credentials, you know, to be taken seriously out there. So, okay, my academic background, undergraduate work, I was a double major. I did pre-med and pre-law criminology. In my last year of football eligibility, I was already graduated and finished with a graduate degree. And my graduate degree was in psychology. And I taught psychology for a while at university. And then I attended a program where I certified as an MICP at Stanford Medical School, which is an elite level of paramedics. Stanford wanted to best everything out there back in the 70s and have like ER doctor skills out on the streets. So I did that for 5 years in a fire department. So I was technically a fireman paramedic. And I felt that I had all that I wanted from more the conventional side. And then I got very good with my hands and mash skills and that sort of thing. You know, really invaluable experience. And then I attended a 4-year naturopathic college, and I specialized in oriental medicine, Chinese medicine, and classical homeopathy. At the time, there is only 17 states that were recognizing naturopaths. So I then got my doctor of chiropractic, just so I would have an alternative license to practice in any state, because my medical certification, I had to work in a hospital, and that's not where I was going. Beyond that, I did a tremendous amount of training and certifications in everything from oriental medicine to Ayurvedic, osteopathy. But my main specialization all these years has been bioterrain medicine, which is like a permaculturist to the body. So what we do is we have a very involved way of assessing the internal ecology of the body. And rather than treating bodies as though they have a disease, because we know disease is really not in existence, it's only ecological imbalances that can be remedied if you know how to work with them. So that's what I've done all these years. Now, in the farming industry, which is what I'm mostly involved with now, I'm a certified master gardener and permaculturist, and a major Northwestern university is using our farm here later this summer for some permaculture events and trainings. I'm overseeing with my wife some other programs for them where we're treating or training low income people how to grow their own food in greenhouses that we provide and build up their food banks with natural nutrient dense food that they grow themselves. Very empowering in many ways. So that's what preoccupies us more. And we also have a medicinal herb farm here where we grow our own herbs that we use in the manufacture of our products, because in the past we were buying organic bulk herbs, supposedly the best quality and so forth, to put in our products. But with third-party testing, we're finding a lot of the reports were coming back that these organic herbs, especially grown overseas, were all tainted with pesticides and all sorts of things. So we knew moving forward, the only way to really assure that we had the best products was to grow our own. So that's, in a nutshell, where we're at right now.
Nice. So there's two things I want to touch into there. First off, the idea of epigenetics, that a lot of diseases are not hidden in your genes, but they're turned on by the environment or the ecological aspects of the life that you're living, whether you're stressed out. We had Bruce Lipton on the show last year who was talking about some of this as well. And this is one of those ideas. That,
wonderful gentleman.
Yeah, right. What a fascinating character, and very, very quickly became a good friend. But this idea that a lot of where our health comes from isn't necessarily about what's going on inside the genome system, but it's inside, or the DNA structure. It's actually inside of the way we think to some degree, or the way we're viewing yes. life, the cortisol levels or the oxytocin that might be released is a balance between the two. So what I want, for anyone that doesn't know what carbon 60 is, this is a fascinating subject. Last year when we had a few chats about it, I was trying to get information from other scientists. I reached out to one or two that I believe work at the Noetic Institute alongside Dean Radin as well. And this is a very interesting growing topic because of what C60 has shown in some of the lab results. You can find it on the National Health Institute's website. There are many peer-reviewed papers there as well. But Dr. Barre, tell us a little bit about C60 and what's so interesting about this particular molecule.
Well, the conventional research is very promising, and there's ongoing research now that people aren't even aware of, even in the C60 community. And that research, of course, focuses on molecular chemistry, and we're talking about the antioxidant powers and the ability to repair damaged DNA and all that sort of thing, and actually lengthen telomeres to by a third. I mean, that's phenomenal. That right there should be on the front page of every media in existence, and would so far be beyond anything that the conventional medical community or pharmaceutical industry is trying to come up with. So it's amazing. But I think in the C60 community, we really need to step up and understand really how it works. Now, this would get into not just ideas, but proven concepts that would be in alignment with, Bruce Lipton and some of the things he mentions, because everything does come from the mind. Now, there is a gentleman by the name of Walter Russell that few people have heard of, and he was actually far in advancement of your Teslas and all those sorts of people, not to lessen achievements of other people, but this gentleman was actually probably the greatest luminary in the last 2,000 years, and he laid out the whole basis of it's people use the term electrical universe, and that's really true, but Walter really explained that there's no substance in the universe. None at all. And there's only pure consciousness. Now, pure consciousness has the ability to produce thought. Thought then is an electrical event that polarizes, and that polarization creates the electrical resistance for the vibrations that then register on our senses. to produce everything we think is real about our entire reality, including our very own bodies, and each of us being co-creators in this process has that ability to produce thought. And what we have to understand, even in the alternative medical community, which I, and again, not to deride anybody, but I think we're still largely in the dark because we're trying to reverse engineer things from molecules and such. And carbon 60 is a good example of that, because we're talking about antioxidants and things on that level, when in reality, the thing that makes C60 so powerful is that it has the most robust waveform, you know, of any other element in this level of simulation. And Walter Russell explained all of those things. And when you go back to Bruce Lipton, and he's talking about, well, it comes from our thoughts. Well, Walter Russell actually detailed how that works. And the average person with a fourth grade education could understand all of this and be well beyond any MIT mathematician or such. And in fact, Walter admonished people not to continue education past the fourth grade, because if you did, you'd have great difficulty unlearning things. And that's what people have a problem doing. So if you look at the periodic table of elements, carbon being one of those elements, what people don't appreciate is when the very first element, hydrogen, appears on the horizon. Now, you're going to have to understand that we're talking about waveforms. And, you know, when you go into electrical engineering books and things, you know, you see waveforms. Now, waveforms in reality are three-dimensional spirals. And those spirals, again, are produced by thought from consciousness. And every waveform has 18 dimensions. And those 18 dimensions can be nuanced to without limit, to create every single form that we think we see. I say that we think we see because what people don't appreciate is our sensory apparatus is also part of the simulation. So if you think you're getting the truth through your senses, what you're really getting is a very graphic and intensely nuanced simulation that shows you exactly where your body of thought and emotion is at any present time. And that is, in fact, what manifests our individual realities and bodies. So carbon 60, carbon, as just even a normal chemist would tell you, it's the most stable structure in the periodic table of elements, and the reason why it's a backbone of everything. Now, I started to say how hydrogen is the first thing that registers to our senses, which is about 33 degrees from the horizon of a waveform. So if you have a waveform and you put an equator through it, you have some peaks of the wave that go above it and then equally below it. So if you look at carbon, it's exactly 90 degrees perpendicular to the equator. Now, when you take that substance, what you're really doing is training your own waveforms to mimic the perfect 90 degree angle of the carbon, and that it is going to make a very sturdy structure and also keep it at the peak of form, which we would consider in our human simulation as a, you know, like when we're 40, we're supposedly at the peak and then it's all kind of downhill after that. That's really not true, but that's our belief system. So that's why we experience that. So carbon 60 really needs to be understood by way of waveform mechanics. So why don't you jump in? Because I could take this in a whole bunch of different directions here, and you'll have to rein me in here.
So what I want to actually, there's a few things I wanted to touch back to was, okay, so we're talking about the shape of, it's a 60-sided dodecahedron, which makes it very sponge-like. So this is some of the information that I kind of gathered from the National Health Institute's peer journals that I was reading. So that this gives it the ability to have those antioxidant effects is because it's a nanomolecular size, it can go into some of the places like inside the cells that the antioxidants can't normally. And those end up cleaning up the old, like what is it, the nuclear, we could call it the nuclear waste of the cells that are running kind of half-mast, which when that happens, it allows the body to clean out these cells. And this was also then what led into the lengthening of the telomeres. So maybe what I would like to do is, can you explain us a little bit what the telomeres are in the body and why they're such an important part to what we would consider the, like the field of anti-aging?
Yeah, and I would agree with everything you just said. But again, you have to realize everything you just said, it should be relegated to after effects. And all of us within a simulation, we can observe mechanisms within nature, mechanisms within our culture and everything we do. So we're not saying that those don't exist, but they are a simulation of the waveforms. And so really, if you want to engineer your body, if you want to engineer your reality, if you want to re-engineer society, you have to do it from the top down, which is understand how it all got here, which just happens to be from our consciousness in the first place, rather than being down here trying to reverse engineer our lives. It's like reverse engineering a Swiss watch and you're just staring at one gear. And that's the present state of science, of medicine, of agriculture. So if we can, again, reverse our thinking from where everything comes from in the first place, we're going to do much better. And in fact, we employ these principles in medicine and agriculture right now with great success. Now, to answer your question on the telomeres, what they really do is they vibrate and resonate at different frequencies, and that is what really makes the body tick. The body, like any other thing within a simulation, is our resonant force fields and pressure zones, when you really get into the physics of it, that create, again, the nuances in the waveforms that will then outpicture a certain way to our senses. So the telomeres are very important because they're have a very pivotal role in creating those resonant force fields that then will influence the outpicturing of the rest of the of our body or whatever we're looking at. Does that answer at all where you were going with that?
Yeah. So what I had gathered was that one of the reasons why the telomeres are such an important part of the extension of life is that our genetic structure starts to basically decay as we get older because the telomeres act almost as a copy code. And that every time the telomere copies a version of itself to create a new cell, you're losing some of the length of that telomere because you could almost imagine as it's a limited amount of data in the telomere to create new cells. So that what happens is as you get older, your telomere's length shortens, which means the ability to produce that really solid DNA structure that you had when you're younger starts to disappear. And that C60's effects on the telomeres show that they either A, are stopping the telomeres from decreasing in length, or even sometimes adding the ability to basically make more copies of the genetic structure. Is this somewhat close?
You just got garbled a little bit and froze there. Could you repeat the last few words?
Oh, sorry, that the telomeres basically act as a copy code so that the C60 has shown positive results in either stopping the telomeres from losing length or actually even increasing the length of these genetic copy codes.
Absolutely, and it depends on what level your perspective is from or what level you're looking at. And in that level that you're describing, I would agree with a lot of that, but I still have to go back to how those telomeres got here in the first place. So if you have a belief system that's surrounded with aging and everything else that we think is inevitable, then every bit that comes down from that point all the way down to our DNA structure is going to mirror that belief system. Now on the ground here, we do the level of research into after effects. That's all they are, is their after effects. And we will see things happening as you're describing. And those are good ways to explain how things play out from the original waveforms that create the whole thing in the first place. But to really understand the efficacy of carbon-60, you have to go back to the waveform mechanics in the first place. And the fact is, there's not one thing in this reality that is not just a wave that is substance. It's all pure consciousness reduced to waveforms, then that will outpicture what Walter Russell describes as the cosmic light show. And that's what dazzles our senses and keeps us from going into those levels where we can see things from the top down. And the reason why I enjoy the martial arts so much is you use movement to embody those same forces so that your body realigns with the primal patterns that were here in the first place, and you get out of the illusion of the overlays, waveforms that have distorted the symmetry of the original patterns and then create every problem we have.
Right. Yeah. So I absolutely.
Go ahead.
No, continue. Sorry.
No, I was just going to say C60 so far in my experience and a lot of people shows that it's unique in its ability because it is carbon to impose the original patterns and that prime peak waveform. Now, there's a lot more about carbon 60 you have to know about. Carbon 60 is very young. And in Chinese medicine, they have these cultural terminologies like yin and yang and so forth. And if you were to take their metaphors that they use and what I first learned a long time ago in naturopathic college, I was trying to understand these things from a conventional Western mindset, and I was open-minded and I enjoyed learning these cultural metaphors and things, but I didn't know how to take them the way they were originally intended. What they understood thousands of years ago was waveform mechanics. So when they talk about yang, what they're really talking about is a waveform that is at its peak, 90 degrees perpendicular from the equator. And if you look at the organ systems, they're all assigned yin, yang, or somewhere in between. The heart and the small intestines, for instance, are at that 90 degree absolute yang position. And in the rest of the organs are all different angulations and so forth, different variations of yin and yang. But because carbon 60 is straight up, then if you don't understand energetics and how to practice medicine or nutrition according to energetics, for instance, in China or Chinese medicine originally, they talked about the elements and everything. Again, metaphors. What they're really talking about is tonal fields. For instance, you know, you have the earth, the fire element, and so forth. Earth element, they're really talking about F sharp. That's what the earth element is. So we're talking about tonal fields and the same exact waveform mechanics that Walter Russell was talking about. So if you're taking carbon 60, like any good practitioner knows, is you want to make sure you balance it out. Now, there's some research going on now showing variations of carbon. Well, we don't call carbon 60 anymore, but will be the counterpart. Whereas those pyramids on the molecular structure of the carbon 60 molecule are actually inverted and therefore the perfect yin companion. So for instance, some of these substances that will, I'm sure, be available in the future would be the thing that you'd want to take at nighttime and balance out, you know, the absolute yang tendencies of carbon 60. And if you have a physical condition, that is of a certain nature, you really want to pay attention to balancing out the energetics, because sometimes an absolute yang remedy, no matter what kind of herb or source it is from, what's going to happen is it's going to be like throwing fuel on a fire. So, you know, again, it's about balance. So carbon 60 absolutely does the things they're finding in research. In my own experience, I see people having tremendous results with it in all sorts of ways, especially cognitive functions. And but again, when we employ it, we take extra precaution to know where a person is at, what's going on, what their level of imbalance is, and then from waveform mechanics, bringing the waveforms that produce their reality, that is their body, we're again restoring perfect symmetry rather than the aberrations and the rubs and the waveforms that start going askew from the overlays of faulty belief systems. So you go back to the belief systems. If you really go deep enough with your own consciousness and you can get over that you're not the little stick figure in the simulation and start understanding how to engineer from the top down, I would argue that we wouldn't need any substance or doctor or anything in the world. And all these other things are just training wheels and really good supportive aids, because we're a species in process or in progress, however you want to talk about it. And unfortunately, we have the predator class on this plane that is obstructing humanity's ability to really once and for all go to the place where we are the creators.
Yeah, so there's a bunch of really interesting conversation there. I've been studying music and vibration my entire life. It's alongside sacred plant medicines. And I've long thought the most effective part of any ceremony is the ability of the shaman or the corandero to actually play the music, because the music does something that no other medicine can do, which is it enters the microcosm and in between the part, like the protons and the neutrons, because of the speed of the wave, that you can effectively enter the microcosm of the patient. Whereas with medicine, you can't do that. You're always operating at this molecular or the matter level that we're talking about. Now I want to stay a little bit into the matter and the side effects, because I think it's a little, for most people to be a little bit easier to grasp or to understand how because I agree with you, the biological computer of the body is a makeup of the system itself. And I also agree with you too, that the mindset of people is a very different thing to change. Now we would probably get into a little bit of an argument somewhere along the way of how much that affects what, because that we see that aside from any predatory standpoint, that the beast body or the division of the whole creates a system of itself and that's why I'm going to get off on a tangent here, and I don't mean to, but one of the reasons why they compared God and Lucifer in the Bible was because if you have something that's infinite upon layers of other infinites, that if you divide that infinitely, the division itself is godlike, because there is no end to the infinite. So the division, which is what they were calling Lucifer, two-thirds of a system. So if you take a scale on the keyboard, you've got C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C, D in this continuation pattern, but you also have red, orange, yellow, green, and blue, the violet. So this repeating pattern of, division is infinite. So I try not to get too caught up in the division of, whether the effect is taking place on the material world or whether it's taking place more so on just the belief world, because it's very easy to take a bunch of psychedelics and have your view of the world change through the side effects of the physical plane. So to bring this back into C60, we originally found it in Shungite and Shulajit. Is this correct? These are the two natural forms of C60 on the planet. And then from there, we realized that we could also synthesize it. And I believe Buckminster Fuller was the first to do that. He called it buckyballs. We started using it as an industrial grease, and we didn't really realize that it had any positive side effects whatsoever. But the side effects are, I think, one of the most entertaining aspects, because that biological computer, I think, to some degree, is going to run on its own, right? We know that if you have a differentiation in between your XY chromosomes and you have an extra chromosome, we see that the adaptation, what Robert Sapolsky might call like a mouth, like a section of an adaptation, the children that have Down syndrome are almost unanimously the happiest, most excited about life people that I've ever seen. So it starts to beg the question, are some of these side effects that are taking place in the matter and the blueprint world, did those lead us to different areas of psychic spiritual interpretation? So my question is, what are some of the physical benefits that we've seen so far, in whether it's long-term use, like you said, clarity of mind, what other physical side effects have we seen from long-term users? And is there other peer-reviewed journals in this space that maybe I haven't seen?
Okay, that's quite a bit there. Well, I have a problem with peer review and scientific methodology. I call it scientism.
I agree with you.
But I hear everything you're saying. Boy, there's so much I'd like to respond to. Let me just make a quick comment. Lucifer is one polarity. And the Luciferian philosophy, you know, I don't believe in a little guy with a pitchfork and horns. That's just me. But the Luciferian religion, we'll call it, is exclusively adapting one polarity, which just happens to be the mechanical materialistic, and trying to do an end around nature by just going at it down one path. And of course, all of our present institutions are based on that, in that they take spirit out of the equation and go exclusively down that one side. And we're also taught that you don't trust your imagination, your creativity, your inner feedback, shamans and concepts like that are a bunch of malarkey, where we know genuine shamans, there's a few out there, are trained to not reverse engineer, but to understand where the forces come from. Then they can readily manipulate matter. So back to your, I think your question is, what we've observed or what we think on the physical side of things, even though I don't believe in physical, what we see on the ground. So neurology is the most delicate component of our anatomy. And because of that, it suffers the most first out of all the things we're exposed to at present time in our world. And neurology, being the most delicate, also is very difficult to bring back once it's been injured. But because C60, again, based on the principles I already mentioned, has the ability to interact on the level of neurology and allow these damaged neurons to actually regenerate themselves by repairing the terminal ends of the DNA. Also, because of the waveform mechanics, again, I believe, I can't prove this, but I don't know how to explain otherwise things that I see. I believe it's actually creating greater networking or synapsing in dormant parts of our neurology that are presently unused. And I think that in the future, going forward, might even prove more valuable than its ability to repair DNA. Because now if we're awakening dormant parts of our neurology, that has implications well beyond just lengthening the terminal ends by a third. Now, the most prevalent thing I do see is changes in cognitive functions, where people that are borderline or overt Alzheimer's, for instance, are getting their lives back. And, you know, in over a period of months, we're seeing all sorts of maladies doing much better. I hear a lot of anecdotal reports within the community besides what I observe firsthand. And my only caution with people with C60 is not that it is dangerous, because there's no known toxicology level. So I feel confident that it's not dangerous in any way. But if you want to do advanced medicine, where the Pythagoreans believed medicine was, sacred, in that it was not just to repair the vehicle so that we feel better, but to align the vehicle with pure consciousness so that the journey of the soul could proceed and eventually get off the karmic wheel, so to speak. So carbon 60, I believe, has much more implications beyond just repair of the physical structure. I could go back into waveform mechanics and explain, you know, things better in that way. But the other things that we notice are inflammation seems to really be reduced in people, especially geriatrics like myself that have old aching joints and things. Things just hurt less. So we know, again, anecdotally, but then it makes sense with the research, and I'll just confine it to the research as far as molecular level research, antioxidant attributes, and the other things we found about C60 on that level do reduce inflammation. You know, for instance, 700 times stronger than vitamin C and so forth. So very valuable on that level. But again, it's about balance, and that's the one caution. If you want to start seeing through the cracks, use C60 for its highest level of use beyond just feeling a little better, thinking clearer, not hurting as much. If it's properly used in a skilled artist hands, you're going to get a lot more value out of it, and also start you know, elevating it beyond just physical attributes and things it's doing to repair and make the body feel better.
Right.
Yeah, I'll say on a personal level, I've been now taking C60 for, you know, I take a teaspoon every morning for going on 3 years now. And so kind of that, I'm kind of that, you know, experiencing that on a very personal level. And I must say that my endurance levels are way up, my ability to work longer, and my dreams are firing like way crazier. Now, I don't know if that's fully connected with the C60, but just on a very like personal level of using it, I will say to great effect, it is very much energized and helped with my endurance and the inflammation aspect. Definitely. I'm a runner. I'm very active, and my knees, I used to have problems with knees. My knees don't hurt like they used to. So that is interesting. I will say on the yang aspect of C60, personally, I do experience that, the fire side, the masculine side, and the energetics. So I am interested in balancing that out more. So having the yin side with the C70 or whatever we're talking about, that is very interesting to me as well, because I will say that sometimes I feel like I'm not abusing it, but I'm pushing it. I'm able to now work longer and get more out of my daily regimen because C60 gives me more energy. And my personal beliefs, and maybe it is just my belief system that is helping me achieve this through the C60. But yeah, balancing that is something that seems very, something that I would really like to explore more.
Yeah, and so just 3 years ago, Mike was totally gray.
Yeah.
I'm just kidding.
I'm actually 65 years old. Yeah, it's wild stuff.
It's doing great. It's doing wonders. So there's a company last year that sent us a few bottles of C60. I took it myself. I was fairly sporadic because I do a lot of traveling, and I forgot to take it with me. So I had no consistency in its taking. And I believe it's probably more one of those Ayurvedic like medicines where you want to take like a small amount every day for the next 60 years so that you don't get sick, or that you don't have troubles. Not whereas Western medicine is, okay, you're sick, let's try to fix it now very quickly with a much more abrasive sword. I've always been very attracted to taking medicines that so I don't get sick, instead of, oh, now I'm sick, now it's time to do something. That I feel that this is one of those ones that functions probably at a more significant level if you're ahead of the curve for where you might be actually having problems. Dr. Barre, lead us into some more of the waveform mechanics, because I have very little understanding of how some of that stuff might work in the body, other than the guesstimates that I've made from my own psychedelic journeys and use of music in understanding union through things like cymatics and the relationship that sound has a very definitive, physical structure to it that takes place. So how does waveform mechanics work inside of a molecular or chemical structure?
You know, waveform mechanics, we'll just highly simplify because there's a lot to this. And even though anybody without a background in mathematics and science can understand this, it still takes a lot of study because there's a lot of information, a lot of dots to connect, and mostly a lot to unlearn. So the best analogy, not even analogy, it's literally the way it works is if you look at music, and you know more about music than I do, but if you hit the major keynotes, you're probably aware that those keynotes that we hear in music are important, but the real melodies and harmonies are through the informational fields between the keynotes, you know, in those intervals. So the intervals are what's important. Now, elemental science has shown us, okay, here's carbon, here's hydrogen, so forth. What they don't tell you is a hydrogen, all the way through carbon, all those elements will take turns. One will become the other, and they will all transition finally back full circle again. So there's no such thing as like carbon is a fixed element in the universe. It's a trend.
Oh, sorry. I just was hoping to show this.
Keep going. I thought I lost you there.
No, okay. Just keep going.
Carbon 60 is a transitional element. And carbon is one of those keynotes. Now, you guys are probably familiar with the concept of ORM, orbitally rearranged monatomic elements.
Back in
1991, I had heard about a discovery made by a soil scientist. His name was David Hudson. And we actually got together shortly after that. And he found these elements in the soil. Now, he was operating, and everybody since, under the premise of atoms, you know, little particles that somehow all get glued together with covalent bonding and so forth and make all the stick figures we see walking around out there, which is kind of ludicrous. And in fact, the atomic theory of matter has been debunked so many times, but of course, you'll never hear about it from the science guy or something. So orbitally rearranged elements are really referring to the transitional elements and carbon, you know, and in science, we also have concepts of isotopes and things, which are variations of a certain element. And there's some distinctions between transitional and isotope, but let's not go there. The transitional elements are the keynote elements that are now in the process of becoming the next element. Now, transitional elements used to be a very abundant in soil and water, and they're very rare now. We have the ability to harvest transitional elements. I have a little contraption that I use to harvest them out of water, and it's a series of magnets and chambers and things, and you run through hundreds of gallons, and then you get a few drips of these elements, the transitional elements that settle out, you have, you know, a pure amount of the transitional elements. Now, the transitional elements, just like the intervals between keynotes and music, are the informational fields that have all the good stuff, not only make music sound good and that sort of thing, but it also are the things that make our body tick. Now, carbon 60, I believe, based on things that have been proven in the field of waveform mechanics, is one of these transitional variations of carbon 60. And there are transitional elements of other things besides carbon. For instance, in some of our products, we have transitional platinum group, which includes gold. And in that transitional state, or what some people call ORM, we've known for a good number of decades now that those transitional elements have amazing properties. And especially if you take the real deal, and if you're also doing your homework, you know, you can't just take a substance and undo karma and all of a sudden become enlightened. You got to do the inner work, but these are great tools that can greatly facilitate that in the hands of the right person. So the ORM, or transitional minerals that we use in our products, have those informational fields that are missing in products that are more just hitting it on the known forms of minerals relative to the periodic table. So you have all the good information and everything. That's why it works. Now, carbon, being unique in that it is the backbone of our entire reality, which is the fifth octave. You know, there's octaves and tonal fields within each octave. And Harriman, who is a great Italian physicist, graphed this out where he showed that humanity is right dead center in the middle of, reducing down animal or, you know, going up to the heights of enlightenment. And the transitional elements, as we understand, when you go through the octaves, the fifth is that exact midpoint, again, where humanity is. So these carbon being that more robust form, and then the carbon 60 being a transitional element of that, is what I believe the reason why it's so it's producing such results, just like we found with other transitional elements, carbon even more pronounced. Rein me in here and go from there.
Well, what's interesting here is I know that, first off, the majority of science is already left in the past. So for the Barre family, I mean, we've had the pleasure of having Thomas Campbell and Dean Radin and yourself, Barre. And I think what's interesting is that I think Robert Choke said it best when talking about the Egyptologists, and that, you know, we have a lot of clearly mm-hmm. defined evidence that the Sphinx is a hell of a lot older than we originally thought it was due to the geographical erosion that's happened around the Sphinx. But the problem is you have all these people that have invested their entire lives into thinking, and not only just thinking, but teaching other people. Oh, did I break up there? But they've invested their entire lives in teaching other people that this is what's correct, that for them to let go of that truth, which is now is actually more of a belief than it ever was a truth, you have to almost wait for some of these scientists to die for the new science to really come out, because you're fighting against people's deeply ingrained belief systems. Whereas I think a lot of people are, what we're trying to do is get people in the Barre family to recognize that our scientific, the facts that we've found in science, because consensus doesn't exist in science. It's not a scientific word in any shape or form. But anyways, the scientific facts that we found are often almost a decade ahead of where the actual, I guess we'll call it a consensus is that these people are believing outdated information because they've invested so much into it. And it's one of the difficult parts. It's one of the reasons why I was also trying to keep us into that thin line between the physical layer and the manifestation of the data and the complexity that the physical body is, as in comparison with the top-down model, which is energy coming into this system, creating the physical world as we know it. One of the things that was, I guess, is this, do we have anything other than anecdotal evidence of the life extension properties? I know there had been some experiments that were done on rats supposedly, but I've found no clear indication of those experiments. Is everything anecdotal in the terms of life extension at this point?
That's a great question. I think it's all anecdotal and including what we consider. And of course, we're taught not to trust that, when in fact, it's the only thing there is. You know, if you understand waveform mechanics, it would explain perfectly how humanity has been hijacked at the consciousness level. But more importantly, it would explain the solutions that we have any moment we care to change our mind on how to take our creative primal forces back. Because right now, we have been purposely indoctrinated so that those primal creative forces coming directly from our consciousness individually and collectively are creating what the predator class wants us to create. And because we're so involved in our senses, in all of our institutional, science and medicine and agriculture and everything, to look at it from the reverse perspective rather than from the creative perspective, we're trying to fix things here. And, you know, we form activist groups and, even myself, we're out there in the permaculture group and trying to bring back sustainable farming and all those kind of good things. And those are things that we should do on the ground. And if we do them properly and do them by mimicking nature and making our practice mimic nature, then not only does that work better on the ground, but it also reflexes back up into the other radiative cycle, which is where everything is created in the first place. But when you have the balance of coming at it from action on both levels, then that's where the real magic starts. So there's no way we're going to change this world as long as this is, I don't see any other way around this unless we change our mind about how things really work. And if we stay hypnotized at the level where we're at, there's never going to be a solution. And even Einstein, who is kind of a stooge of the system, kind of a cutout for the whole scientism movement, even he said, you can't fix the problem in the same box from where it was created. Mike, you look like you wanted to jump in with something there.
Well, I was just going to say, this is the age-long conflict that humanity has been unfortunately facing since the fall of Atlantis. So it's the materialists versus the mysticists, and what real science is, and, quote unquote, what metaphysics has been trying to ascertain. And I believe that, yes, there are control systems, as you call the predator class, that thrive on the materialism. But I also am very much, I'm very positive feeling about where the future is going with decentralization, with new technologies that will allow for humanity to freely have discussions like we're having right now, stuff like blockchain and cryptocurrency, and things that will allow for us to break off these centralized control mechanisms and allow us to kind of, as free thinkers, start to make up our own minds. And it's going to be a long way going, but as we move into this new age, I really feel like we're going down that path towards healing and towards really starting to understand reality. And with that, as we change our belief systems, we'll find out that things like carbon 60 are just like a cool new gateway drug towards this understanding. And that the carbon 60 is, as you were saying down the line, if we can really come to full understanding of the true powers as infinite consciousness, that's what where the real science lies, not in the materialism, not in the base on pulse and all that. It's based on going inside. So yeah, I'm very much feeling good about where we're going in, and that's why I'm so involved with like blockchain and stuff. And I want to extract this information that Barre has, because he's one of very few left in the world that understand this stuff, and get it on the blockchain so that we can have this information for future generations, and so where it's not put in memory hole, because that's the thing I feel humanity is always facing, is we have private institutions and think tanks that take this information. And that's why we have kind of sacred occult and secret societies that have this real knowledge, and they keep it hidden. And memory holes of mainstream societies, so that we are lost, they can profit off this and as predators. And so, yeah, I really feel like, shows like this are really important. It helps with the awakening. And that's really what it's all about, is the awakening. Because with the awakening, we can change the consensus. And with the consensus worldwide, then we can start to see real world effects towards our belief systems and start to really fix all the problems we have in the world.
And Tio, just so you understand a little bit more where I'm coming from, and a big believer in anecdotal, is I've been a clinician for over 40 years. Now, I've done all the schooling on both sides of the fence, keep up with research and everything, even though it's molecular and things that I understand from a different perspective. But in my career years, we had international clinics with live-in spaces and things, and people would come from all over the world. Now, I always operated in private rather than being out in a commercial street corner hanging my shingle, because we had to do things in a way, because we were getting good results, very predictable results. And the average people, we'd have like 2-year waiting list to come in to see us. And the average person was referred by other doctors for people who had success, and they all came in with so-called terminal diseases and that kind of thing. And so when you're in that situation, all the research and everything, it's great background noise, but it doesn't take care of business. So if I do things and notice over a period of years, over thousands of people, that you get certain results, even with a certain degree or a high degree of predictability, you have to say to yourself, there might be something to this. Now, if I waited for all the double-blind studies and all the scientism community to give me the blessing to do what I do, then we never would have been able to help people in the first place. And in fact, when you go into traditional European Bao-Terrain medicine, Chinese medicine, the real stuff, not the traditional Chinese medicine. I learned in naturopathic college, which was a bastardization of the whole People's Republic of China to take spirit out of it. You know, I did apprenticeships with the old timers from the old country and learned in different ways. So when you learn how to do the real stuff, then you see, again, predictable results based on your practices. And very often they do not conform with the principles of scientism. So when I get into issues like carbon 60, I have to go back to the fundamentals of creativity and the way shamans actually are trained, the real ones, because they're not all real out there, but the real ones really can see through the cracks. And why they can is because of their understanding of all these things that I'm talking about. Now, of course, they don't get their understanding by reading books written by Walter Russell or anybody else, because Walter would be the first one to tell you, well, information is good, and I like all the information I can get. I'm an information junkie. But information is worthless until you apply it. And then when you apply it, it becomes experience. And then experience becomes knowledge. Now, the scientism community does not allow doctors, researchers, and all the people involved to have a real experience. They just say my way or the highway, and we're kept in this same box, in the same vicious loop, and never getting anywhere. And meanwhile, in the activist groups, whether it's alternative medicine or cryptos or whatever, that's all amazing. But until we start, remember, we've been hijacked in consciousness because everything's been inverted, literally inverted. So until we reverse the polarity of our thinking, not just thinking, but then experience from that, we're never going to find a solution.
Well, I will say this too.
Go ahead.
The real way, what you're talking about doesn't fit within the current model of the way economics work. That's why crypto is important. That's why we're working on things to change the notion of how currencies and how wealth generation should work, because healthy people isn't profitable. Sick people's profitable. No. So how are you going to have a medicine, industry thrive off healthy, prospering, conscious people? It doesn't work that way. So there's a bigger thing that needs to happen, right? There's a whole paradigm shift, and all of this needs to work together for us to get to a point where the average Joe can go into a clinic like yours and have this experience, because there's a new sense of how community and how currency and how society functions.
Yeah, and the predator class realized a long time ago that they could not control nature, but they could control analogous fictions that they created. So that's why on day one, when we're born, there's, a fictional entity created in our name that they control us with from that point on. They control us by having our belief systems aligned with their fictions, and then get our agreement in many different ways to participate. And then now we're under the control. So again, the control is at the level, the highest levels of consciousness. And until we realize who we are, and in fact, all the great ones of all time, you know, the Buddha, the Nazarene, any, the Pythagoreans, you know, the ancient Vedics, and so forth, unanimously, you know, emerald tablets, all unanimously tell us the same exact thing in so many words. Ample evidence right now of past civilization that created based on this knowledge, not the inverse that we're stuck in, and created civilizations and technologies far less of where we're at right now. And the rest of that are still there.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that. And you know, I've been one of the jokes that one of my mentor in business is a fantastic gentleman. We have been discussing toxoplasmosis. So for anyone in the audience who doesn't know what toxoplasmosis is, it's a parasite that was originally found in rats that cats can get. And what it does is it actually attacks the fear centers in the brain of any mammal. So this, Robert Sapolsky does some great work on this area as well. But he talks about how if you can give this parasite to deers and they lose their fear of cougars, you can give it to, if humans get it, it's hypothesized that some 50 to 70% of the human population has it because they own cats. It's actually very easy to get. But it's essentially nothing but a brain parasite that attacks the fear centers. Now, I don't know how long mammals have had to been around for this parasite to exist, but the fact that it can cross species and have the exact same effect is one of those ideas where I'm like, okay, well, the predator class, I think what has happened in the world of the woo-woo that can be quite difficult sometimes is that I think the reflection of the matter or the material world is creating itself based off of, let's say an inflection, or you could call it an inversion to some degree. But it seems very likely that instead of some like Illuminati, which is just a far greater conspiracy than I'd ever like to imagine, that just everyone has a brain parasite that makes them not scared of that they're normally supposed to be scared of. So we have this erratically unfearful society that's become more predatorial-like because of its lack of understanding of the regular perception of fear that it should have had. I always try to...
Exactly.
A great deal of my work, I try to steer away from the more of the controversial aspects of how we got to this place, and I try to find a natural answer. And toxoplasmosis is one of those kind of funny and ironic ones that, you know, over the thousands of years since the Egyptians, and our love for cats has slowly infected the planet to the point where we're known, because there's a really interesting study that shows that the high level entrepreneurs are often very likely the same people that have toxoplasmosis, because it removes your risk of fear, which means you might bet the entire farm on Bitcoin instead of do what's a less fearful path. And that entrepreneurialism or capitalism to some degree also follows that nature. So I would put heavy bets on a lot of this stuff coming from brain parasites.
Well, I think a lot of it has to do with the dual nature of our reality, the polarity. It's the positive and the negative, and the systemic means in which individual consciousness choose to go either route. So that's, you know, and it just comes down to physics. So yeah, the predator class, a lot of people are victims within that. They become predators because of this nature of reality. So, but yeah, that doesn't help. That's why pregnant women are told to stay away from litter boxes. And I think like there's some studies that show that a great number in Brazil have this, like over 50% of the population in Brazil have been shown to have this. And that's why they're good at soccer. Or there's just like a lot of crazy stuff like that. So yeah, I mean, obviously the physiological aspects of our reality play a big part in what's going
on. Absolutely. And even countless hours looking at people's blood under the microscope and doing laboratory assessments. I do in-house where we're, you know, gathering, you know, specimens for molecular treat, but then we extrapolate it to resistance equations to understand what that really means on the electrical level. We also have instruments created by physicists, engineers that can pick up the waveforms emanating from things. We apply that to medicine to study you know, blood and that sort of thing. Now that's and I just saying that in preface to, I agree, we do see things on the microbial level, and there's a lot of engineered microbes these days that make things even more complicated. But on that level, within the simulation, it is real, especially if you're suffering from it. But why do we succumb to that in the first place? Why do some people get certain maladies, certain parasitic infestations, when others don't, when we're all subjected to them all the time? The answer is varying degrees within the same belief system, you know, relative to fear levels. You know, we talk about consciousness producing thought that produces our reality. Well, thought forms cannot enter the matrix, so to speak, unless they have enough velocity to do that. And the velocity comes from our emotion. For instance, if you're starting a business or any kind of enterprise, you can't just have a thought bubble and have things just magically appear in your life. You have to have the passion and so forth behind it to give those thought forms the velocity to then appear. Now, when we're under superstitious beliefs that we are not sovereign beings, that we owe somebody else a living, that we have authority figures that we have to obey because they wrote words on a piece of paper and then have given themselves permission to use violence to enforce them. And when after, you know, centuries of humanity believing that they don't even have a right to prevent encroachment within their own personal space, then that has to, as above, so below, outpicture to every level of reality that we experience, including being vulnerable to cellular and microbial events that couldn't possibly have their way with us or so forth, unless we were operating under a belief system that we had no say about it. So again, it always falls back to finding out who are we, where, what is our place in the creative cycle, what are our true abilities, how do things really work, and there we have all of our solutions. And that's why they've externalized everything into these fictional realities that you know, we buy into. And, you know, our money system is a beautiful example. And you folks being in the crypto world, you know, are, you know, doing brilliant work to free humanity from this slave system, which is the only way it can be explained. But they take the natural order, and rather than banks now pertaining to the land structures that control and direct the current of a river, we have banks that control the currency that we call money, because they have led us to believe that our self-worth is now externalized into these little units of exchange. That's how we measure everything. And now they've got our entire life force for a lifetime under their control, because we're chasing our tail, trying to get their little baubles that they created. And then not only that, but then you get a whole bunch of them, and then they want half of them, you know, back in the form of taxes or something in the first place. So they would, the predator class would have no power. Microbes and other cellular events, things we call cancer and everything, would have no clout at all if we were operating from the top down rather than inverted, thinking that we're the little guy in the game, you know, that we're watching run around on the screen, rather than, hey, we're the actual person with the joystick here.
So yeah, I think that's a super, sorry to interrupt, but that's like the most empowering message behind Alpha Vedic, is like, we are all creators in our reality, and we can do whatever we want in our life and make whatever we want. And it's super empowering message in the end. It's not like a dark, like, oh, there's, you know, predators and we have to, you know, we're battling them and blah blah blah. No, it's, we're kind of just having a very pragmatic view on the nature of the reality on this planet right now, in that sense, but also with the idea that, hey, you create your own life, you can go out and do whatever you want, really. That's the same with your health and with your family and with anything you do in your life, because you are the one that is, manifesting your reality in the simulation.
So
Alfa Vedic is, go ahead.
Oh no, but I'd like to save part of this conversation for after we jump off the show, because we're just about to roll a little over
okay.
the hour and
sounds good
mark, which is kind of, it's a nice place to shut it off here. But let me just, I'm going to open up the Alfa Vedic site. I'll share it with all you guys so you can see it. There we go. So hopefully our faces aren't too much on the side, but you can go to alphavedic.com. You can check out some of the great products they have here from coffees and teas. The C60 is obviously what we're focusing on today. It's been a highlight of one of the studies I've decided to take up, mostly because I'm interested in that thin layer between the two stories. Again, like I said, the potentiality of, well, whatever, we won't go too far into it. Check out alphavedic.com. You can find them on a few of the other social platforms as well. I will leave all of their links down below if you guys are interested in trying Carbon 60 out. None of this is health or medicinal advice. This is strictly for informational and educational purposes only. So please, just like everything at the Barre family, do your own due diligence. We want you guys to research, because these are fascinating topics of study. I've been fascinated by this stuff for the last 2 years because of the potentialities of the side effects and the benefits, which are, again, I think a big part of the interest, anywhere to clear up and work a little more smoothly. You guys have a bunch of other products on here, so what we'll try to do is get you back on the show over the next few months so we can go over some more of this stuff. Dr. Barre Lando, Mike Winter, thank you guys for joining us today. Barre family,
thank you.
Right? Smash that like button if you enjoy this content. Subscribe to the Barre family. And again, remember to check out Alfa Vedic for some of the great products that they have on there as well. Not a sponsored review or anything, by the way. I'm friends with both these gentlemen. So this is, what would you call that? A personal referral.
And we'll say the same. We're education focused. We always stress to anybody who's discovering us to do your due diligence, because that is where your knowledge comes from. That's where your self-empowerment comes from. First and foremost, we are an education-based company. And that's why we're going to be doing more podcasts ourselves. We'd love to have Tio as a guest on our podcast. And while we're out there trying to educate as much as we can through the products and through media and such.
And we're about agri-medicine, and the Alfa Vedic products are part of a permaculture design in sustainability. So we use our products to fund our farming, our education, our research in medicine, and rather than doing our farming and so forth, trying to get research grants and government funding with strings attached, we want to be free and clear and create whatever the heck we want. That's why we developed the company, to sustain ourselves.
Yeah, a beautifully important model. It was a treat to have you guys both on the show today. We'll keep in touch. Barre family, thank you all for joining us. We'll see you guys on the other side. We hope you had a great time. Thank you all for joining us.